So I think if I could have your attention, I think we'll go ahead and get started. We're on Columbia Standard Time. It's 5 minutes late, but we may actually be a little ahead of time. It's a pleasure to welcome everybody to this seminar. This is the sixth of the Dean's seminars on chronic disease, and as advertised, it is focused on the natural history of good ideas. You know, in clinical medicine, diseases are described in terms of their natural history. This is when they start and how they start and what happens to them, so on. So ideas also have a natural history that begins in the temporal lobes and various other places in the minds of people like the people in this room, and ends up, one hopes, with some kind of application in behalf of health, and in this instance, in behalf of reduction in the incidence and prevalence of chronic diseases. The pathway from the minds, the pathway from the generation of ideas and formulations of problems to application is a very tortuous pathway, as you know. It's impacted by the interests of various groups and individuals at interest. And the successful application, for the most part, requires partners, primarily in the case of efforts to go to scale with disease prevention and mitigation, primarily government. So the issue today in today's seminar is, as I say, that pathway and an examination of how public health, and in particular academic public health, and first-line schools like this one can be more effective in shaping what happens, in modifying what happens to that trajectory, that tortuous pathway from mind and from academic considerations and formulations to application. And the guerrillas, in a sense, along that pathway, I hope you don't mind, that's a fairly impassioned formulation, are tucked into something known as the political process. Between ideation, between cerebration and policy is politics, is health politics. The effort in putting together today's seminar was to see how we can be more effective in influencing the political process so that the product that emerges bears some reasonable resemblance to the ideas and to the ambitions that went into it. Somebody has said somewhere, there are two things you really don't want to watch being made. One is sausage and the other is policy. The analogy is not, I think, is not too wild. They're both messy, in some instances unattractive, and the product that emerges is not quite, doesn't bear a tight resemblance always to the inputs. So in any event, to clarify all of that for us today, we're very fortunate to have two genuine experts, people who've been importantly involved in informing the policy process at various levels for a long time. Our distinguished visitor is Dr. Derek Yach, who is Senior Vice President of the Vitality Group, something I hope he'll tell you four or five words about so you're oriented, where he leads development of the Vitality Institute for Health Promotion, a major effort of a very large international insurance company. He's had an extraordinary career, starting with his medical education at the University of Cape Town Medical School, from which he holds the MBChB, followed by a baccalaureate degree in epidemiology from the University of Stellenbosch in South Africa, and a few years later, an MPH from the Johns Hopkins School of Hygiene and Public Health, as it was known when he went there. He has served as executive director for non-communicable diseases and mental health at the WHO, as director for global health at the Rockefeller Foundation, as a member of the board of the PAHO Foundation and the Global Health Advisory Board and the Global Agenda Council on Food Security of the World Economic Forum. And just prior to his present appointments, you won't find this too discordant, I hope, he was vice president for global health policy at PepsiCo. At PepsiCo, which is now an enormous holding company, I guess you could say, for a very large number of food products, he labored to reduce the health challenges offered by numbers of those products, and I think it's fair to say with some success. He has published extensively on tobacco-related issues, about which we'll hear more this morning, on health inequalities and chronic disease control, and importantly, on policy at the national and the global levels. Our distinguished faculty experts, Professor Michael Sperrer, who, as you know, is chair of the Department of Health Policy and Management here at the Mailman School. Dr. Sperrer holds a JD from Rutgers School of Law and a PhD in politics, as a matter of fact, from Brandeis University. He even served as a practicing lawyer for some 8 years when he was assistant chief of the Affirmative Litigation Division. If you're not familiar with the concept of affirmative litigation, I hope somebody will ask him what that is. It seems seemed to be a little cognitive dissonance in that term. Anyway, he worked in the New York Corporation Counsel's office in the Affirmative Litigation Division for 8 years. He's been on the Mailman School faculty for more than 20 years, is also an adjunct professor at the Weill Cornell Medical College and the Graduate School of Medical Sciences, Cornell University. He's published extensively on health policy and health care reform, on federalism in health care, and on the interface between federal and state programming, particularly with reference to Medicaid programs. He is the author of 11 books and monographs, largely addressing the health care of low-income populations. The introduction to his monograph, which is up here on the table, ends by advising all of us to give attention and respect to the implementation of new ideas. And that's what we're here for today. And what we'll do is start with Professor Yach, who will speak for a while, and then Dr. Sperrer, and then we will have, I hope, time for discussion, questions, challenges, whatever you like. So, Derek, it's all yours.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction, and it's really a privilege to be back at Columbia and have a chance to speak about a topic that is both professionally important and has been personally important over the last few decades. I hope to try and take the theme of the linkage between politics, policy, and law and explore it in very real ways through actions that I've either been a chance to be a witness to or have some influence over. And certainly we'll end with some challenges that we're going to face, both for you and for society. I always try to start off any talk dealing with public health policy with reminding people that it must start with epidemiology. For without the epidemiology, we don't know why we should be bothering with an issue. I particularly was struck by the work of Sir Richard Dawe, which showed us very clearly that there were large life expectancy gains that we could achieve by better tobacco control through a cohort study that he lived with for over five decades. And while the evidence has become refined since, his seminal work remains the basis for action on tobacco control. We can improve health and wellness very powerfully, and I think you know the evidence base. But there was another type of evidence that we will also explore as I start moving ahead, and that is the degree of distrust that exists between public health and industry. And the story will become clearer as I move ahead. But I thought many people would be unaware of the what I think is the origins of the distrust before we were too aware of the nefarious activities of the tobacco industry. And they really were in two little documents written by Mike Muller for the War on Want in the mid-1970s. The first, The Baby Killer, gave rise to the notion that infant formula was killing babies in the third world and spurred the start of what was initially the next slave boycott and what to this day remains massive distrust between the worlds of food, nutrition, and public health. It was a small pamphlet he put out which nobody actually thought anybody would take any interest in, and it was only when Nestle translated it silly for them into German in Switzerland that it actually exploded and became the basis for what I'm sure a lot of you are interested in. But people forgot, maybe you've forgotten, that Mike Muller produced a second little document, Tobacco in the Third World, also by the War on Want, that highlighted the impact in 1975 and the projections of what was going to happen if we allowed the unfettered expansion of tobacco use throughout the developing world. I particularly like this story because Mike Muller is a good friend and colleague of mine who, after spending time with War on Want, went on to work in Mozambique before its independence, and then went on to become the first Director General of Water Affairs in the Mandela government, and is now a Professor Emeritus at Wits. When I started looking at the data as a student at the time, I was 12, by the way, in 1977, it struck me that I needed to hear from the other side. I wanted to know, what did the tobacco industry have to say about the evidence? And so I went off to go and see them in their laboratories in 1977. And they persuaded me that the floors were very clean, the environment was exquisite. They paid the best wages to black workers of any company in South Africa under apartheid, and they really did. And as I pointed out, the only problem was their product killed half the end user. That man at the back there, Mr. Malheba, actually became a friend of mine, even though he was a chain smoker. And he gave me data which I could not get from the public health world to write this first article I ever did on the economics of smoking. I cited and thanked him in the final page, which didn't do too well for his career after that point. And this paper, written eventually in 1981 when I was at the Medical Research Council, the Medical Research Council forbade me to publish under the name of the Medical Research Council because of their concerns that the tobacco industry would bring down the wrath on the MRC at the time. So in fact, it's written under my home address with no link at all to the MRC, and you'll see the irony of that. A few years later, though, the MRC realized that the change was coming to South Africa and saw tobacco control as an important area to start reaching out to the outside world. And so the South African Medical Journal agreed on occasion of the first World No Tobacco Day ever, 25 years ago, to have a complete journal devoted to the evidence, the epidemiological, economic, legislative evidence of the what needed to be done about tobacco control, with the then president of the time, A.J. Brink, the same person who forbade me to publish the article, now actually authoring the editorial in a journal that had an impact on public policy in that we started the discussion around advertising controls at a time when the prime minister was a chain smoker, de Klerk. But he actually did reach out and say he wanted to look at the evidence because he was concerned. But action was delayed because even though we had the evidence, the politics wasn't yet right. Interestingly, at the time, I was studying and working in as an epidemiologist when this paper came out by Alvin Feinstein. Many of you may have read his work. He's no longer with us. He was a professor of clinical epidemiology at Yale and became really the father of clinical epidemiology. He wrote a piece in the mid-1980s called The Scientific Standards in Epidemiological Studies of the Menace of Daily Living, which basically made the point that we live in a risky world, everything's a risk, big risks, small risks, you know, you take your chances, and if you read it, really, it underplayed the value of doing anything about anything. because it's such a risky world. And I always found that a very interesting article, which in many ways undercut the arguments we were making that sound evidence must be needed to drive policy. He was saying, well, yes, that's true, but actually it's a very risky world. I read it at the time and forgot about it. You mustn't forget about it. I'll come back to it. The start for the political opportunity arose when Khoza Zaina Zuma came out of exile and joined the Medical Research Council and me in a meeting we held in Zimbabwe in the mid-1990s. She had yet to be appointed as the Minister of Health by President Mandela, but went to the conference in Zimbabwe and for the first time announced that the African National Council Congress would take a strong line on tobacco control. It would increase taxes, ban advertising, ban smoking in public places, and do everything that the world community was calling for. People didn't really believe it at the time, but it had a huge impact, and the conference had a big impact, so much so that you can't see it down here, that interestingly, there were articles written by journalists questioning whether we should be using WHO norms to drive tobacco policy. Again, I couldn't quite understand why they were doing that at the time. Eventually, I did know, and I'll share that with you. It was the first conference ever where, a tobacco conference, where farmers were invited, because the Minister of Health and I, who were the organizers, felt that we should listen to the voice of the poor farmers from Malawi and Zimbabwe. And the most powerful line, which has lived with me since, is a simple line by one of the heads of the Malawi tobacco delegation, saying, I'm a farmer first, a tobacco farmer second. What he was saying was that give me an alternative at an equivalent return on investment and I'll grow it. I'm not growing this because I want to grow it. I'm growing it because everybody's come with support from British American Tobacco and helped me grow this stuff. Give me an alternative. And for years, we were unable to find alternatives. The consequence is what we see in Malawi today, just in the last few months. One of the largest shortages is hitting Malawi, and they're having to import large amounts of maize at exactly the same time as exports for tobacco are continuing to boom. One of the benefits of Zimbabwe that I learned, and will later again also become more important, was that nobody believes you in your own country when you talk about policy change or what matters. So it didn't matter how much I spoke about the power of tobacco taxes being the driving force of tobacco control. The government wasn't particularly interested, and the incoming government was kind of still not sure what it was doing. Until after the Zimbabwe meeting, we brought David Sweener and a team of legal experts to the country and held a meeting with the ANC where they immediately got it and agreed that when inauguration had happened, in the first budget of the South African government's new budget would be an increase in tobacco tax. And in fact, that's what happened. From that year, from 1994, there have been continued increases above inflation every single year. And it was done on the basis of the win for tobacco, not on the general need for revenues, which is also important. So there was in South Africa struggling. And I think many people find you struggle at a country level to make progress. It was a unique opportunity because suddenly South Africa was drawn into the international scene and international conferences. And the power of the international conferences came through to me when we had a chance to go to the World Conference in Paris in 94, the year of inauguration, and also carry the same message of the plans of the South African government. One of the most important speeches was given by Ruth Romer, who has died since. She was Professor of Public Health Law at UCLA and an advisor and doyen of public health law for decades. Her late husband, Milton Romer, I'm sure you probably also know, the father of modern health systems analysis. Ruth's point was that national sovereignty was being threatened by global tobacco control marketing, by global tobacco marketing, sales, and transnational actions, and that only a global solution was going to solve the problem, and that that would require WHO to use for the very first time its legal right to actually use treaties to control transnational flows and activities. That was not very popular at the time, and it was raised but kind of fell on deaf ears because the politics inside WHO didn't actually allow it to go anywhere, even though there was a little background work done. We were able to support it and talk about the threat to South Africa's tobacco control policy if we didn't have that, in a paper also given there, which highlighted the opportunity of political change to actually bring about tobacco control. What got things moving was a Bellagio meeting, and anybody who knows about public health will know that a large amount of public health initiatives come out of Bellagio meetings. I'd like to say that this one really did even better than most. This was a meeting when I was luckily representing South Africa there. Many of the people in the picture over the years to follow played leading roles in tobacco control, or at least were sensitized enough to support it. Judith Mackay became the doyen of tobacco control and got the highest awards from Queen Elizabeth for her efforts. Vera Costa Silva took over from me when I went to WHO, led tobacco control in Brazil. Raul Oranga was at the time head of UNCTAD, something you've never heard about, the United Nations Conference on Trade, which had the responsibility within the UN to accelerate tobacco control, but basically did nothing. His main interest was in donating organs, the type that you play, to his home country of Argentina. And he was really there to try and ensure nothing happened. That was a lot of what the UN focus was, appointing people to make sure nothing happened. And nothing happened in tobacco control. The person who tried to get something going was Neil Coleshaw, who was head of tobacco control at the time, now in Canada. Richard Peter was passionate and put the data on the table, a disciple of Dorr. Alan Lopez, the co-author with Murray of The Global Burden of Disease, again, stressed the data and was head of substance abuse at the time. Michael Erickson became the head of tobacco control at CDC for many years and in partnership later became a key player and in crime with us. Howard Barnum, for the first time representing the World Bank, said that this is a threat to the economy of the world, but didn't have any money to prove it. And the head of CEDA, the Swedish development agency, Eva Wallström, also was there and got sensitized to the need to put money into it. And I won't go through everybody else, but out here, does anybody know who that is? That's Nils Dallaire, now head of global health in the federal government in Obama's administration, playing a key role in driving public health policy. What came out of that was the idea, we've got to have global action, but we need to build it on evidence, and we basically were waiting. What we were waiting for? We were waiting for a political break. In the meantime, we could start building the intellectual case. And part of it was through work we did in a document that got accepted at the World Health Assembly called Health for All in the 21st Century. There's some text here I won't go into, but basically it was endorsed by the World Health Assembly, I think without them realizing what they'd fully endorsed, which basically said, as global interdependence increases, so will the need for global ethical and scientific norms, standards, and commitments, including those that are legally binding. Legally binding. What we were doing here is reminding people of WHO's Article 19, the right to have a framework convention in an area of public health interest. You must remember at the time, most public health people did not, and many probably still do not, understand the role of international law in developing norms and standards. The international health regulations had languished for years and were not being resurrected, and the use of that article was seen as a threat by many sovereign countries to their ability to decide what to do. So we needed to have more than just words. We needed to build the case, and the case was based on a few realities. First, that there had been a build-up over 40 years of resolutions of the World Health Assembly, stressing both the evidence and the need for action and actually implementing actions. So warning about the hazards for 8 years, driving some activities on advertising and marketing, stressing the role of taxation based upon the evidence, and then starting to alert the world to the need for an international strategy. Why this is important is because this build-up over time creates a set of norms among the foreign policy analysts and the health policy analysts, stressing that we need to act together in a concerted way. These things do not happen overnight. We were able to show that there were going to be material transnational issues that needed to be addressed. Taxes and prices. You raise taxes, you stimulate illicit trade. Packaging, design, and labeling had enormous implications for trade regimes and for the trade regulations of WTO. Smuggling and falsification we knew was a big rising threat in parts of the world. Advertising and sponsorship, on the one hand, threatened some of the concerns around First Amendment protection in this country and the equivalent in Germany, and fears that the advertising industry was going to collapse, which is what we were told. As you can see, it didn't. Tobacco and agriculture policy, where the tobacco farmers were pretty weak, but those representing them through the industry were very strong, and they said, well, the economies of Zimbabwe and Malawi are going to go down the tubes if you go this route, which is the case. They did go down the tubes, but not for that reason. And then some of the scientific aspects. We need to regulate the toxic constituents. And this is where I think we didn't make enough progress, and I'll end with that. When Dr. Brundtland took over as the head of WHO, it gave a real opportunity. And in her, before she even took office at the World Health Assembly, in her acceptance speech, she invited the member states to initiate work on the Framework Convention to take the first step. And she wanted the treaty finished before her end of her first term, in 5 years. Now, anybody who knows anything about treaty making knows that you can't specify the end date of completion. It's impossible because there's so much you can't decide in the negotiating process. But those were our marching orders. And she gave some advice at the time, which we then looked at. Reframe the debate of smoking away from individual frailty to a failure of corporate accountability. A huge issue that I'll highlight. Strengthen surveillance and the economic case. Establish coherence across multiple alliances and limit opposition. Titrate the work with governments according to their readiness and ability to act, and establish alliances of leading countries and leaders. I won't go through all of these, but I'll show you how some of them were done. First, on evidence. The global burden of disease provided compelling, powerful data of the need to act. I don't need to go through it. At the time, the figures were 5 million deaths worldwide, projected to grow to 9 to 10 million within 2 decades. The evidence was summarized, and we synthesized it in partnership with the World Bank and the IDRC in a number of documents that gave case studies from countries of successes, of impediments, and then all came together in an atlas that's been updated every year since that highlighted the trends in trade, the trends in economics, the trends in epidemiology, the trends in sales, the trends in legislation, and even more. Very importantly, I mentioned Howard Barnum's frustration in not having supported the bank to do the analytic work. We obtained the support through Norwegian trust funds to establish a unit in the World Bank, especially to build up the economic case. WHO wanted to do it, and many of us felt that that would not be a good idea. The best people to advocate economic arguments are the World Bank. And even though that meant going through the tough rigors of some very different economists in the World Bank to meet their criteria for what should get supported, it made it. And the outcoming document, Curbing the Epidemic, was a handbook used by colleagues in the negotiating process to talk to the Ministry of Finance and explain to them tobacco control will be good news for you at least for the next 5, 6, 7 decades. And it really started harnessing the power of the financial world alongside the public health world. What have I done? Okay. The data then was spelt out in national data. So in South Africa, colleagues produced updates on the economic costs and benefits of smoking in South Africa that were then repeated around the world. And we started producing data looking at the trends and affordability of price increases, making the point that in most countries of the world, the level of excise tax was way below what would be optimal for health, and that considerable increases would actually give you a large runway to generate revenue and reduce consumption simultaneously. There was a fear that as consumption dropped, revenue would drop. Well, in no country have we actually reached that point yet, even though we are still seeing taxes go up and even though the prevalence base is declining in many parts of the world. We recognize the importance of surveillance, and I highlighted Michael Erickson at the Office of Smoking and Health at CDC. One of the first things I did when I was to go over to CDC and see how the federal government could support global tobacco control. And while in the end they didn't sign the treaty, and hopefully one day they will, they were very critical in providing support to build what is now the largest largest surveillance mechanism for almost any problem in health in the world. From an initial discussion around CDC starting to do global youth tobacco surveys in a couple of countries to get the youth smoking trends, since we believe those would be very powerful in the hands of policymakers, it's expanded now to 168 countries. The surveys have been repeated up to 7 or 8 times in many countries and are repeatedly used as a powerful policy tool in countries. There's a little bit of the data which has never been analyzed, and maybe under the Freedom of Information Act, some of you may want to go after it. I felt that I was interested not only in smoking prevalence of kids, I was interested in the brand-specific smoking rate of kids, given that over time, the type of marketing, the type of influence on packet design is actually tied to the brand. I was more interested in looking at the trends over time in the Marlboro-specific smoking rate in kids, given that Philip Morris had said it doesn't sell to kids. There was also the potential of recouping losses through charging companies proportionate to the smoking rate among kids, since that is illegal. The problem was, though, tied up in, as I said, CDC's bureaucracy and how you could release data on corporations. But it is collected, and one day, hopefully it'll be analyzed, and one day many of you who do tobacco control will stop reporting smoking rates per se, but actually report brand-specific rates. A new type of evidence was also needed, and that came out of the break of the Minnesota court case. The Minnesota court case, for the first time, required that the tobacco industry divulge all their documents and put them into a public repository. So we, of course, went off and looked at what did they say about WHO, and had a commission of inquiry chaired by Zeltner, the head of the Swiss Federal Health Agency, including somebody from Transparency International, Faisal Randera, who was at the time the head of the Human Rights Commission in South Africa, and a number of others. And their report to the head of WHO and the World Bank, these are some of the quotes from the report. WHO is the leading enemy. We should attack WHO, discredit its individuals, contain, neutralize, reorientate WHO. And the key conclusion was, evidence from the tobacco industry documents reveals that tobacco companies have operated for many years with the deliberate purpose of subverting the efforts of WHO to control tobacco use. The attempted subversion was elaborate, well-financed, and usually invisible. We went back through the documents, and then I went back to the article by Alvin Feinstein and was intrigued to find in the documents that he had been paid to write that article. The contract is available in the public space, the size of the contract, he probably got it between $2 and $6 million, either directly for Yale or for his own departmental use, not for his personal use. Is available, again, on public websites now. And the actual editing of the article was done to meet the needs of R.J. Reynolds at the time and had exactly the effect that they hoped. It caused debate around disputing whether the evidence was real. Here's one article from the Wall Street Journal. These articles I took directly from the Philip Morris website, by the way, required to be in the public domain. We went on and did far more analytic work showing the systematic evidence, the systematic way in which the tobacco industry junked science to promote tobacco, that they developed a whole range, a whole notion of sound science, which basically meant that an epidemiological study with a relative risk under 2 could not ever be true. And of course, that would mean that none of the environmental tobacco smoke stuff could be true, neither could a lot of environmental stuff be true. The best case study of that was something, if you haven't ever read, is compelling reading, was the way in which the industry subverted the International Agency for Research on Cancer, or tried to, who were doing a 10-year study looking for the first time at environmental tobacco smoke and lung cancer. They spent as much money trying to either stop the study, change the findings, confuse the public about the findings as the cost of the study itself, which is about $2 million. And to this day, there's still some people who believe there's no evidence linking environmental tobacco smoke and lung cancer, partly because of the successful work of the team that tried to dispute it. I found records of the personal surveillance that I was under, some of them quite amusing, going back certainly 20, 30 years. One of them was a fear written in a BAT document that I was going to convince the government of South Africa to ban tobacco sports protection. And then it goes on to say, don't worry, we're taking steps, it'll never happen, we're going to deal with him and forget about it. They were wrong, I'll come back to that. So as we started the work on the treaty, we knew how they worked. We knew the minds of the industry. And we knew that we were going to put that in the public domain, which we did, and invite them into a public hearing when we start the work on the treaty, which was unheard of. So we invited the tobacco industry into a public hearing, and these folks gave their arguments. They thought the treaty was not a good idea. Voluntary action would actually solve the problem, and they were willing to stop advertising to children. Well, we didn't accept that. Very importantly, Brundtland at the same time knew that she did not want the tobacco industry to say that this was an anti-industry and anti-business effort. It was against the tobacco industry, but she was very pro-industry and very pro-partnerships with all other sectors. And that's why deliberately timed was a major announcement in Davos at the World Economic Forum of a partnership between Glaxo, Novartis, Pharmacia, and Upjohn on a smoking cessation program across four countries in Europe, which we later expanded, which was chaired by the CEO of Merck, Gil Martin, who became a very strong supporter in the corporate world for tobacco control as well. And that was a very important break, because it meant that we could talk to the corporate world about tobacco control being a legitimate issue. Isolating the tobacco industry was actually what we were after. I won't go through the mobilization of civil society, but clearly the role of NGOs was important. And what worried me, and many of us, was that at the time, this is 1998, NGOs were mainly actually based in developed countries with very few indigenous strengths in developing countries, and yet those are the voices we needed. The break came was when Ted Turner threw his $1 billion down on the table and said he was going to create the UN Foundation. And we became the second grantee for two programs that he supported. One was called Channeling the Outrage, which was an effort to build a media network around the world inside all the major channels to actually carry the story of tobacco control and the ways of the industry. The second was the Don't Be Duped campaign, which led to the creation of the Framework Convention Alliance, which is now an alliance of 200 NGOs around the world that once they became up and running, became and are now a very powerful force for strengthening the aspects of tobacco control. Very importantly, we had to also address the fact that in a number of countries, we faced unique threats. And we particularly were concerned about Germany, Japan, and China. And we needed, obviously, special strategies for them. And I can't go through them, but I'll just say the Chinese example was the release of the report showing that 1 million Chinese were dying of tobacco was done in a very high-profile way, where the evidence was presented by Richard Peter and Gro Harlem Brundtland to the president of China in very clear and explicit ways. I don't think actually it had much action at the time, but it certainly meant that they did not oppose the treaty and in fact supported it. In Germany, it was even more important. If Germany voted against the treaty, we would lose the entire European Commission because they were bound by an agreement that they act as one. 25 countries would get lost. So we had to have Germany on board. And so we had a very harsh strategy with Germany where we would go and give talks about the complicity between the German government and Rietzma and Philip Morris based on documents, so they couldn't say that it wasn't the case. We think that is one of the reasons that helped in the end for Germany actually to do nothing and to stay quiet and to go along with the consensus in the European Commission, even though until literally hours before the final signing, we didn't know which way they would vote. And in Japan, it was more interesting. For whatever reasons, we held a number of meetings on women and tobacco at a time when nurses' smoking rates were starting to take off and where vending machines are still in the office of the Ministry of Health. The Japanese government, by the end of, let's say, this process of intense engagement, had a 180-degree turn and turned out to be some of the most positive negotiators for a stronger treaty, and to this day have continued trying to make change. I mentioned my efforts at sport. Well, I think we succeeded. We saw that while we're dealing with the dark side of industry and whatever, we also want to get the upside. We want sports to be positive and vibrant, and we wanted them rid of smoking. And the successes really achieved were the International Olympic Committee hosting a special meeting at Salt Lake City, with Kofi Annan and Bishop Tutu actually opening it, on tobacco-free sports, a strange arrangement, but that's what we had to do. Or the FIFA World Cup in Korea and Japan, when that became the first time the World Cup went free for smoking for soccer, and it continues, by the way, to this day. Within the UN, we had a unique problem, and that was that part of the UN was funding tobacco activities in farmers, the World Bank, FAO. Others was trying to oppose it, the airline people and ourselves. Some were doing nothing, UNICEF. And so the creation of a network within the UN to actually agree that we needed coherence across the UN agencies was critical. Raul Arango, who I mentioned before, the Argentinian who had the job at UNCTAD, was shifted, and Kofi Annan gave that responsibility to WHO. And with WHO in the leadership, we were able to get unanimity on demand reduction being the central goal of UN policy on tobacco. Nothing else would take precedent. And that actually opened the doors to the World Bank terminating all loans, FAO terminating all loans, and us then being able to make progress. The one surprising one was UNICEF, where we worked with UNICEF and put out a report that's also long forgotten, but it's out there and officially endorsed, saying that the Convention of the Rights of the Child, their Bible, requires that tobacco control be assessed throughout many clauses and articles and reported back to the body, the convention body. Carol Bellamy came out supporting it, but since then and for a decade, UNICEF has done nothing. I won't go through this because I'm going to have to start ending, otherwise I know the trapdoor is going to open. But I would just say that some of the other underpinnings at the time was to reverse a massive trend on no research in tobacco control, which was again done by the US federal government, where the Fogarty Center created the Fogarty Tobacco Control Unit that continues to this day. And for 10 years, this research they funded wasn't just important because of the publications, but because it built a cadre of new thinkers. And talking about new thinkers, we saw the need to bring in people who most people were unaware of anything to do with tobacco control to play a leadership role. And each one of them, without them, we wouldn't have the treaty today. And I'm sure many are never acknowledged in the world of tobacco control. I won't say what they were doing then, but Jonas Støre is today the Minister of Health of Norway. He was Chief of Cabinet at WHO at the time. He then became the Foreign Minister. Roberta Walben was the analyst for Michael Cerisi and the firm that actually did the disclosure documents and spent a year with us thinking through how to use the documents effectively as an advocacy and a legal tool. Celsa Amarin was the first chair of the convention, and he was a Labour person from Brazil, became the Foreign Minister of Brazil and is today the Defence Minister of Brazil. Jeff Wigand, you may remember, is the whistleblower who had a movie made of him, which Crow actually starred in. Also, a very powerful voice giving us insights into what happened. And then Oliveri Toscani was the creative designer of Benetton and helped up the ante on the kind of quality of media that we were able to produce. So finally, March 1st, 2003, everybody agreed, 3 a.m. Little did they know that we only had money to actually have the translators in place until 6 a.m. I still, to this day, don't know what happened if it had happened. I'm not going to go through the objective, but just to say one point here. In the treaty, you'll find something very interesting. The word trade doesn't appear, and I'm sure you'll find that very interesting. But it starts with a line which says, determined to give priority to their right to protect public health. That is read as code by WTO in very important terms. Simultaneous with the signing of the treaty, WTO Director General, with a lot of backroom work, issued a formal statement saying that in trade disputes related to tobacco, the Framework Convention would be used as the base document to make the decision. And that continues to become very important as we move ahead. And why I mention it is that often in public health, we had advocates demanding that we be far more explicit about trade in the treaty. There would be no treaty if we'd gone that route, because the trade and foreign policy folk would never be willing to accept trade issues in a treaty that was only going to deal with tobacco when the trade issues are so much more complex and wide. What is unique about the treaty is that it has this line, recognizing the need to be alert to any efforts by the tobacco industry, and a complementary article on liability, which again stresses the fact that the polluter needs to pay in some ways. So the framework convention status today, 176 members and the European Community of Parties. Some significant ones are not yet signatories, but we hope they will be. But the story doesn't end there. The latest data on the burden of disease shows that tobacco is still the second or first most important cause of death worldwide. We know very worryingly that the trends in women and girls are dramatically changing while we speak, and nobody is causing a fuss proportionate to their action. Many of you, I know, have had your careers in HIV/AIDS and other areas. I hope you're going to look at this and realize that this represents the future disaster for women's health over the next 3 to 4 decades. Basically, it shows that here the ratio of men to women smoking from the latest data, and obviously the bigger the number, the more the higher the ratio. If the ratio goes below 1, it means that girls are smoking more than boys. And for Argentina, Chile, US, Bulgaria, and Russia, that is the case today. So it's been a reversal. In every case, the gap is closing, with girls smoking substantially more relative to boys than their parents were, basically. And if you translate this into numbers, we're talking about millions of women will die with certainty over the next 3 to 4 decades, because nobody is taking the epidemic of tobacco control in women as seriously as they've taken other epidemics which were preventable. And this image here was the original Marlboro image before it got turned into the cowboy. I suspect it's coming back to haunt us. So what do we need to do? 4 minutes? Okay. I won't go through all of that, but I'll just say that one thing that happened after the tobacco treaty was signed was the BAT share price returned to actually continue rising, which sends a very interesting message to us. We are going to have to think very differently and think about the fact that these industries are not going to go away despite everything. At the peak of the negotiations, they were going into a discussion around bankruptcy at this point. Well, this is not bankruptcy. Public interest in tobacco has declined, according to my effort at playing with Google Trends over the last decade. Physicians have failed to take action in their own place, and there are plenty of studies showing that physician advice is still paltry. And yet, the positive signs are that just in the last few weeks, President Obama announced a 94-cent federal increase in taxes, based upon this study by the Congressional Budget Office, showing that an increase in the federal tax would be good news for the revenue of the country, good news for the health of the country, and very good news for debt reduction, offering us new opportunities for analysis and work. Illicit trade, though, with taxes rises, and I wanted to just remind people that it was a decade ago, after 9/11, that the Bureau of Firearms hosted a meeting with us here in the city because they were concerned about Hezbollah money coming from smuggling between North Carolina and Massachusetts because of the price differential. It took a decade for that meeting to finally lead to a protocol to the Convention on Illicit Trade that was endorsed by all member states just last year. And when I mentioned Malawi, the options for Malawi are opening far better than we ever thought. This is an example from the company I just came from showing that the chickpeas for hummus are now growing on tobacco land. This is not just important for the US. It turns out that the price for chickpeas are high enough now for Malawian tobacco farmers to also start switching, but they will need money to do it. And that money is a requirement of the Food and Agriculture Organization, which has a standing resolution and has had for 30 years, that if countries want to switch, they need to apply for the money. No agricultural minister has, because of the power of the tobacco industry. So I think when we finally come down to, we talk about policy, let us remind ourselves in the end, each individual smoker makes a decision to smoke or not smoke in this policy arena. Some of the more innovative work by Kevin Volpe here, looking at the role of incentives to increase smoking cessation, are ones that, where I am now, we are particularly focused on. And I think that the next wave is going to come from us acknowledging that while there are, in this country, almost 40 million smokers, getting them to switch entirely out of tobacco is not going to happen overnight. But there are alternatives. And we need to open our eyes to what is the e-cigarette mean as an alternative. Many in public health, and hopefully we'll discuss this, don't even want to talk about the fact that we could have a people using a vaporized nicotine device with zero potential health consequences, but the regulatory regime currently is still deciding, are they going to encourage smokers to move in this direction, or is this a bad way to go? I put this up because the decision is going to be based on sound science, a mixture of understanding nicotine dependence and the neuroscience on the one hand, and the epidemiology and public policy on the other side. If we get this right, and the rate of increase in e-cigarettes has gone from nothing to almost $1 billion by the end of this year, we may have a solution closer in hand for many of the smokers who are trying to quit. And even further, when we start digging into the brain, we're realizing that our greater advances in genomics are showing us that some people respond to price increases and others don't. And one of the determining factors may be the presence or absence of a particular gene that drives some of your acetylcholinesterase in the brain. Now, you can say this is really weird and whatever, and it's too deterministic. But the point of putting it up at the end is to make the point that high-level policy, blunt policy, tax, advertising, has got us to a certain place. It may very well be that now we need to dig into neuroscience, behavioral science, genomics, and behavioral economics to actually get the job done. And nothing of this will happen if we don't continue to have the political will that I mentioned and you started off with. If you get it right, can you show a difference? Well, this is the latest data from South Africa, which we'll be publishing shortly, showing the rise and the increase, very high rates of smoking in the 70s and 80s, the start of some of the policy interventions, and the complete decline in prevalence that continues today. We're starting to level off and we're worrying about it. This translates into hundreds of thousands of lives saved across a population. It shows it can be done in a low middle income country if you've got political will, if you apply science, and if you work with your finance ministry. And where I am now, we're now just starting our own journey with a special World No Tobacco Day poster for all of you. Thank you very much.
Fantastic. We're going to morph right into Dr. Sparrow. And are you wired, Michael?
No.
At
some point,
all right. Thank you. That was terrific. Thank you, Derek. And I don't want to talk for too long because I want to make sure that we have time for Q&A and people have an opportunity to ask about some of the politics and policymaking of that case study, which is really interesting and fascinating. I also want to just very quickly, because she asked me to, and I think it's the right thing to do, just acknowledge that our dean, Linda Fried, who's in at John Hopkins today giving a talk, asked me to convey both her welcome, her greetings, both to Jerry and to Derek, and also said very affirmatively that she plans on watching every minute of that video right there. So, hi, Linda. Thanks to Jerry for inviting me to this. It's interesting for me, yesterday at 5 o'clock, so less than 24 hours ago, I was standing right here as part of a panel we were having with Steve Brill, the reporter who wrote an article a couple of months back for Time magazine, the longest article ever published in Time magazine, which really tried to look at why it is that the United States spends so much more money on healthcare and medical care more generally than any other country in the world. And he wrote this long article, and he had you know, very interesting sort of observations and anecdotes, and it really hit the mark in lots of ways. And the panel yesterday was particularly timely. It was particularly timely because earlier that day, There was a front page story in the New York Times pointing out that Kathleen Sebelius had just announced some new regulations that the federal government was putting out, requiring hospitals to post their charges in ways that had not previously been posted, and sort of putting all this information out there. And by all accounts, including Sebelius at Health and Human Services, the Brill article in Time magazine was one of the real impetuses and real motives and real pushes for the regulations and the new push at the federal government to increase some transparency in that particular arena. So why do I tell this story? Well, in part because I'm now standing up twice within 24 hours in the same place giving a talk, very different topic, not talking about hospital prices here today, but in part because I think from my perspective anyway, and this is a somewhat new area for me because I've focused most of my work in slightly different areas, but you know, as I thought about and think about this area, it seems to me that if you want to talk about the politics of chronic disease management, or if you want to talk about the politics of chronic disease prevention, and we just got a terrific case study of one illustration of that, if you want to talk about either of those things, number one, you really need to have a sense of why it is that the sort of the traditional health/medical care system here in the United States and really around the world does such a poor job, I suppose, of both preventing and managing the care of the chronically ill. And also, I think you need to have a sense of why it is that not only is the traditional healthcare system arguably failing the chronically ill, but the public health and prevention system, is extraordinarily underfunded, undervalued, underappreciated. And what are the politics of that? Why is that? What are the politics of these two arenas, both the traditional healthcare system and the public health arena, that have led to this situation where we're spending $2.8 trillion a year on classic healthcare here in the United States, less than 3% of which is on sort of government-sponsored public health and prevention activities. And as we think about this issue, I think it's important to think about what lessons actually we could draw from the Brill talk yesterday, not so much about the substance of what he was saying, but about the politics of hospital pricing here in the United States and lessons of that emerged from his article and what's happened since. So that's what I want to do. I'm going to take just a few minutes to do that and then try to open this up. And Jerry, make sure that I'm on time because I know it's now 12:34 or so, and we have to be out of here by 1, and I want to leave time for people to chat. Let me sort of just, again, 20 seconds on the obvious. Everybody here knows it. I think that's why Derek probably didn't even raise it. You know, chronic disease more generally, however you define it, is sort of, you know, growing burden. Study after study after study, you know, the rate of death and disability due to chronic disease, the rate of the costs of the healthcare system due to chronic disease, escalating, problem, high on everybody's agenda. What do we do? Interestingly enough, as high as this issue is on the agenda, we have a lot of talk and a lot of pilots and a lot of programs at the federal level, at the state level, internationally, at the global level, within other countries around the world. Lots and lots of ideas, to use the phrase that you talked about early on. Lots of ideas. And yet translating those ideas into first effective policies and then implementing those effective policies, or those interesting and important policies, into effective solutions seems to be beyond our scope, at least on a grand way, in a macro kind of way. And so why is that? I mean, I think, you know, if you look at the two biggest buzzwords in American healthcare politics today, if I asked you, I'll give you my own two. I suppose people can come up with different. I mean, the two biggest buzzwords to me in American healthcare policy and politics today, number one is care management, and number two is value-based purchasing. Everybody talks about care management and how we need to sort of manage the care, particularly of a chronically ill population. And everybody talks about how we should try to use financial incentives and all sorts of you know, new techniques to change reimbursement systems so that we can nudge providers or nudge consumers or nudge whoever along in a variety of ways so that through the use of these incentives, we could change behavior and change activity. And yet, despite the prevalence of those buzzwords, despite the prevalence of the pilots, we seem to be getting very little result. Let me just give you three quick examples. Federal government, state government, private sector. Let me give you three examples. Federal government. Pretty clear, Medicare, roughly 45 to 50% of folks on Medicare, health insurance program for the elderly and disabled here in the United States, 45 to 50% of them have five or more chronic conditions. They cost 75 to 80% of all the Medicare money. Medicare is a $600 billion program. So this is big money we're talking about, and this is a lot of people. There's 45, 46 million people on Medicare. About half of them have five or more chronic conditions. They're costing 80% of that $600 billion overall. So federal policymakers say, oh my gosh, we have to do something about this. Let's create, let's fund, let's think about pilot initiatives. Now here we're talking about sort of not prevention per se. I'll sort of get to the prevention public health piece of it in a minute. But here you're talking about a health insurance program, a big federal health insurance program, saying we need to, we're spending way too much money on this chronically ill, elderly, or disabled population. We need to think about pilot initiatives, programs to try to sort of get a handle on this, to both reduce costs, to improve the access of those beneficiaries to good quality care. Let's sort of see some magical results. So, Medicare funds 34 programs around the country in the 90s and early 2000s. Disease management programs, quote unquote, care management programs, quote unquote, care coordination programs, quote unquote, 34 different pilot initiatives, all relatively small, but all pretty interesting, all implemented by leaders in the field on the ground, grassroots. Medicare says, let's give some money to you guys, and you figure out how to better manage the care of this elderly, disabled, chronically ill population. Focusing on, again, that population saying we gotta do a better job of it. Last year, 2012, Congressional Budget Office issues a major report sort of synthesizing the literature on what we know about those 34 studies, 34 pilots. And it's a very, very depressing report for those of you who've had a chance to take a look at it. Basically, the bottom line is we're not saving any money. We're reducing hospital admissions a little bit for some of those chronically ill in some of the programs, except actually the amount of money we're spending for nurse care managers and others is actually more than we're saving in hospital avoidance in these particular populations. So we're not saving any money, and we haven't really had any significant impact on the chronically ill elderly Medicare populations in these 34 programs. Yet, of course, if you look at the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, enacted in March of 2009, it's filled with pilot after pilot, program after program, talking about accountable care organizations, talking about medical homes, talking about health homes, talking about patient-centered medical approaches, talking about integrated delivery systems. So here, too, we have clear federal idea, policy, saying let's better manage the care of the elderly and disabled and the chronically ill. Doesn't seem to be working. Doesn't seem to be working, at least on a major scale. States, I mean, I have over there every state in the country. If you talked, and I've talked to a lot of them, because I'm on the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation has something called the Medicaid Leadership Institute, in which we work with Medicaid directors around the country, and I'm on the National Advisory Committee of that particular RWJ program. And so I talk to a lot of Medicaid directors. You talk to any Medicaid director in the country, and they'll pretty much tell you their number one priority is better managing the care of the chronically ill, low-income chronically ill in their communities, their rates of diabetes, their rates of, whatever it is. Again, you know all this stuff. I'm not telling you anything you don't know. So they all say, how do we manage the care of this population? How do we manage the care of this population? So I did a report for RWJ that I guess is sitting over there right now that looks at 20, 30 years of history of state Medicaid managed care initiatives managing the care not only of the chronically ill, but trying to manage the care of the young and the disabled and all sorts of different folks. And again, I wrote it, but it's sort of a depressing report even for myself to write. Sort of dismal results, you might argue. Dismal results. I mean, when, you know, Medicaid agencies are not saving any money. Access is not really being improved. Quality doesn't, there's no real evidence of improved quality. God, you know, who knows? You know, private sector. Years ago, some of you, many of you may be aware of this, you know, Ed Wagner and others, they come up with these chronic care models. They say, oh my gosh, we can come up with these approaches to managing the care, you know, of the chronically ill. We got six steps to follow. They lay out their six steps. You know, we're going to have sort of a much better delivery system. It's going to be informed in all sorts of interesting ways. The chronic care model and similar, that one itself is now in 1,500 practices across the country. There's other folks that have similar kind of models. There's a whole literature on, you know, looking at those efforts. Lo and behold, you know what? In some of the more highly motivated small practices, there's some evidence that there's some delivery system changes and some improved quality and access. But on the whole, pretty depressing story. And now in the private sector, we'll see how it goes, and Derek can speak to this much, much more knowledgeable than I. You know, I'd say every Fortune 500, every Fortune 1000, every Fortune 2000 company in the country is much more engaged now. They're saying we want employer wellness programs, we want to sort of, you know, we want to think about what the return on investment of employer wellness is. We want to basically get into this game. We want to sort of manage the care, or better understand and prevent, you know, both manage the care of those of our populations, that those of our workforces that have, you know, some chronic illnesses right now. But here we want to sort of shift into the public health world. We want to sort of prevent. All right, so let's switch. That's the healthcare system. Let's switch to public health and prevention. Again, I mentioned less than 3% of our dollars spent on government-sponsored public health and prevention. Actually, if you look at sort of the prevention piece of the public health dollar, it's even, you know, even slimmer and thinner than that. Why is that? Well, I mean, there's a lot of writing, there's a lot of literature, you know, there's a lot of arguments, there's a lot of things you all would say. I mean, public health is invisible, you know, we don't know when we succeed. If we succeed, if we fail, everybody knows. We've got a, you know, we're an individualistic country here in the United States. Everybody wants the latest and greatest high, you know, high tech, particularly for their kid or for them. That's, you know, there's a lot of money in the high tech. You know, we have a culture that often blames people for you know, we're divided. Is obesity, you know, is it caused by these sort of, you know, lazy folks who just don't exercise enough and don't eat right, or is it caused by some sort of systemic thing? I mean, there's a lot of people in this country who would say, you know, it's just, you know, why should government public health agencies get involved here? This is really an individual matter. People should stop smoking. People should take better care of themselves. What's it, you know, this doesn't fit with our political culture. There's powerful interest groups involved that are involved here. You know, lots, you know, people talk about the rule of rescue, you know, well, much, I mean, to save one life, you know, we're willing to spend more, you know, than to perhaps save a population. But, you know, if that's the front page of the New York Post tomorrow, you know, that's going to be sort of where the dollars are. So there's all these sort of different theories, different arguments out there. I actually would think, and I'm sort of looking at the clock here and want to sort of end in a few minutes, I actually think there's a couple of lessons that political science could suggest here. I want to mention an argument. You know, to me, it seems the main lesson from political science in the last 100 years, and if I had to say one sentence on what it is, I would say it's that policy creates politics. You know, and that the success of any particular policy is going to depend in large, any particular policy proposal is going to depend on the cost and benefits of how that policy proposal is distributed. You know, And again, there's some well-known efforts to sort of take this whole notion and sort of define and argue and sort of make it much, much more both theoretical and real. But, you know, the notion is if you've got a policy proposal that only affects two interest groups, but it doesn't affect the broader public, that's what the political scientists would call client politics. Those interest groups will battle it out. One of them will win, one of them will lose. If, on the other hand, you have a policy proposal in which the benefits of that proposal accrue to a small group, but the cost is dispersed largely among the population, well, that policy proposal is very likely to succeed because that small influential group is going to have a lot more influence and a lot more power than sort of the dispersed, you know, uninformed public. But vice versa, on the other hand, if you've got a policy in which the costs, of the policy are imposed on a small group, and the benefits of the policy are writ large for the public, then it's going to be very tough to get that kind of policy implemented. It's going to be very tough to get it implemented, and you need what's known in the literature as entrepreneurial politics, is the argument. You know, you need a Ralph Nader, or you need a Rachel Carson, or you need a Steve Brill, maybe, or you need a Maya Bloomberg. You know, you need someone who's going to be sort of a real entrepreneur for the idea, because you're basically taking an idea that people are not all that focused on, and you got to defeat a small group. So I think historically, anyway, if you look at a lot of public health initiatives around prevention, you could say they kind of historically have fallen into this entrepreneurial politics dilemma. Look at the soda tax, or the ban on soda argument here in New York City. Arguably anyway, if framed as, you know, a policy proposal that's going to have a sort of fierce and sharp and profound cost on, you know, a soda industry, with the benefits sort of just amorphous and rather large to the public at large, it's going to be very tough to get that kind of policy through. And there you see sort of, you know, you need a Bloomberg, or you need someone who's going to say, I'm going to basically be the entrepreneur for this idea, I'm going to push, I'm going to be the Nader against GM, I'm going to be the Carson, et cetera. So I think there's something there. And I think you see that story with Steve Brill, you know, and sort of, you know, sort of taking on in sort of the vast sort of costs of hospital and healthcare more generally right now. But I think if public health is going to rely, and this is where I sort of will close because I'm looking at the clock. If public health, actually, and I think the same story, that's in the public health arena, say the soda tax and soda ban, and I think you could tell other stories. And I think listening to your tobacco story, I think actually I could see pieces of this in there as well. We could talk about that. But I think you see the same story in why some of the Medicare demos are failing and why Medicaid managed care doesn't seem to work as well. I mean, you're talking about trying to change delivery systems, which are going to help the population at large, the chronically ill at large, but have a profound immediate cost on the income of doctors, the income of hospitals, the income of pharmaceutical companies. You know, it's a very imbalanced kind of arrangement, kind of politics there. And there's no real, you know, policy entrepreneur sort of pushing for, you know, chronic care disease management. So I think the way you have to sort of think about, so the public health community, I think, has two choices here. Either it could continue to say, we're going to be sort of a niche-based part of the health system. We're going to be a small little niche-based part of the health system in which our successes are pretty invisible, in which basically we will achieve victory on occasion when there's an issue in an entrepreneur, there's a disease, there's an epidemic, there's a disease outbreak. I mean, there's something that sort of focuses the public in an immediate way. You know, either it's the policy entrepreneur or it's the, you know, the breakout of some bacterial disease because somebody ate the wrong thing at Wendy's. I mean, there's something that sort of grabs the public attention. And you gotta either wait for those moments, or you gotta find the right policy entrepreneur, or you gotta change the politics. And I think you gotta change the politics. And what we wanna do, I would argue, or think anyway, is you wanna change the politics away from entrepreneurial politics toward interest group politics. And how do you do that? You do that exactly the way Derek was talking about in the initiative around sort of global health there. You have to sort of get and engage the business community, I think. You have to engage communities to understand that this is not simply an initiative for the sort of, this is not simply, you know, sort of do-good public health folks who've got these grand ideas that are true, but that there's cultural resistance to, there's interest group resistance to, there's problems, et cetera, versus these powerful vested interests. You've got to basically make it into sort of a fairer fight, you know, a fairer argument. You've got to engage the pharmaceutical companies against the tobacco companies in that particular example that you gave. You've got to try to engage, I think, all of the interests and make this more about sort of how do we have a political battle around two sort of competing interests in an American political system that is designed and created deliberately going back to the 18th century to make it hard to get policy through Congress. You know, Medicare could do a little pilot here or there. States can do a little Medicaid managed care initiative here or there. But if you really want to change in fundamental ways, funding streams and distribution of money, you got to change the politics. And I think you got to move the politics away from we're going to rely on a Bloomberg or a Nader or a Brill to a politics in which the sort of the interest group dynamics are fairer and more, you know, it's sort of it's a fairer fight. That's not easy to do. That's not easy to do, but I think that's one of the missions and tasks that we ought to be thinking about. And until we get there, I think, you know, the movement to try to actually improve both the prevention of chronic illness as well as the better management of care for those who have some sort of one or more or five or six chronic conditions, that movement, I think, is going to be, you know, sort of overwhelmed and have a very tough road to hoe. Let me stop there. Thanks.
Finally, understand the concept of affirmative litigation.
Well, no, affirmative litigation means plaintiff.
Oh, it means having you for your lawyer. So we have time for comments and questions. I think just so there's an opportunity to do this before people have to leave, would you just join me in thanking these two extraordinary people? And so. Comments, questions? Yes, would you like to just use that?
Hi. I don't know if this works, but anyway, to link the two pieces together, the rumor I've heard, which I have no idea where it came from, but it's that if we succeed in smoking cessation and control, it will overwhelm our health systems because of all the people living longer. And I haven't actually seen it debated in a scientific way, but I think it's an essential next step question.
The CBO projections that I gave took that into account, and that has been looked at in great detail. I mean, there are two arguments. The one, the Philip Morris argument, when they did the study in the Czech Republic, said to the Czech government at the time, do not go ahead with any tobacco control. It's going to be too costly. People are going to live longer, and it's going to bankrupt your economy. They then withdrew the study because they were wrong, and also they realized that the morality of it just didn't play out right. But the actual CBO data shows that on net balance, yes, there'll be a lot of people living longer, which is hopefully what we want, and they will incur some extra costs, but on net balance, the increased revenues far outweigh that to the government than the costs. So I think that's CBO conservative data to look at. It's a great report.
Michael, any comment? Another question?
An absolutely riveting set of talks. I really enjoyed and got a lot out of it. I was there at the Paris conference in 1994, and I remember the excitement around tobacco control. It seems like we've lost some steam. That's one observation. My question is, how do you take on special interests as a researcher, as a public health advocate? Back in Paris and back in New Zealand, where I worked on tobacco control, we took a lot of flack. People called us fanatics. How do you counter that?
We do it in different ways. I swim every morning, which helps. I think first you've got to have a growing constituency around you, and keep the goal in mind. I find every few years new people come to recognize just the inherent correctness of the cause. You're also right that we have seen a waning of interest, and I suspect the next 2 years you'll see some of it return. And I'm hoping it's going to come because this is the 10th anniversary of the signing and there are a lot of activities planned. I think also public health often just moves with the money. So we saw the money move from tobacco to obesity, so many of the people moved to obesity and the tobacco money collapsed. The legacy money in this country collapsed and suddenly you had people taking their eye off the fact the biggest killer in this country is still out there, still killing, but the passion and the media are no longer behind it. So it's a long-term journey. And I'd say the only other bit of advice which I give to everybody, because I take it every 6 months, go back and read Ibsen's The Enemy of the People. And remember that your job in public health is to be permanently branded as the enemy of the people.
Michael.
So that's interesting. I never would have branded myself as the enemy of the people, but it's good to know. And actually it raises a question, and I think your question about the researcher and the role of the academic here is a complicated one. Because I think for the researcher and the academic to have the kind of influence that you're talking about some of those studies had, the researcher, I think, should be viewed not as an advocate. The researcher should have some sort of objective, you know, I mean, again, we can have a long debate about objectivity and the role of objectivity, et cetera, but I think to the extent that the researcher becomes branded, and this is actually, we could talk about this, I think to the extent that the researcher, him or herself, becomes branded as part of the, you know, the political force one way or the other, there's a time for that, I think, but there's also a danger in that in terms of the credibility of your research. My bias has always been, you know, to try to sort of do whatever research I do or have the epidemiologists do whatever research they do and let the research talk for itself and then let the research be used, you know, by others however it's used in a variety of ways. But I think it's, you know, it's a complicated question because I think the researcher is not always, you know, cannot always stand on the sidelines. And when the researcher gets involved, how the researcher gets involved, and what that means for your own career as a researcher and academic, I think is a very tough question.
Can I just add one line?
Yep.
I'm unaware of when the research ever speaks for itself. Ever.
My goal in writing that synthesis about Medicaid managed care initiatives was to have a report that synthesized the literature that did some additional research, and I might not have achieved it, but the goal, and it's actually, you know, I've gotten calls from state officials and CMS officials, and the CBO asked me to come, and GAO asked me to come. I'm not trying to give myself credit here, but I would take issue with the argument anyway that the research never speaks for itself.
All right, we have time for another.
Going from everything you went over with the history of the tobacco industry and policies to control tobacco, how would you tie that to current work on obesity? And how should we think about taking on the food industry like we took on the tobacco industry? What similarities are there and what tactics should we learn?
I'll tell you that we have a minute and a half to take on the food industry.
My view when I was at WHO was the same as it was when I was at PepsiCo and is the same today. And that is that while you'll probably find that there are many behaviors which are similar between any industry, they all lobby in pretty harsh and strong ways, and particularly in this country, there's a lot of money. The response from public health needs to find where there's common ground with the food industry. And you need to be ahead of the leading companies, showing the way that actually you can create the incentive for them to increase sales of healthy food. There is no, the option in tobacco was fairly limited at the time I was working. Now we're even at an intriguing point of the tobacco industry because many of the tobacco companies are starting to buy up the e-cigarette companies. Would I be happy as a public health person if every smoker on the planet turned to an e-cigarette tomorrow? Absolutely. I would declare victory and encourage the marketing of e-cigarettes wholesale all over the world and price them down to zero, because I know that my public health goal of reducing to almost zero the lung cancer, cardiovascular, and associated risks would have been achieved. I have no interest in penalizing an industry if they're not causing harm. In the food sector, the e-cigarette equivalent exists, except it's much wider. It's a huge array. Changing the pricing, the commodity pricing, the marketing, the distribution of healthy foods isn't just an issue for you to seek common ground with the food manufacturers, but the food manufacturers, the retailers, the insurers, the agricultural producers, the small farmers across this country are all natural allies, and they're all entrepreneurs, by the way. drawing a stronger coalition of the willing will help you move ahead much faster, and it'll address what you're saying, that you won't have to fight one single isolated group that we had to with the tobacco industry at that time.
I think we'll close it. Please thank them again. Absolutely knocked it out of the park. Thanks very much.